Hello, I just thought of making an update to the Parallelism in C++ series now that it has been a week or two and I have gotten lots of feedback. After episode 1, a few people wonder whether it is actually possible to encapsulate those horrible looking but powerful intrinsics into a nice template class interface. And the answer is yes it is. In fact, there is already considerable power prior work about this. For instance, there is a relatively new library called boost.simd that is just for that purpose. I highly recommend you to check it out. It even has the trigonometric functions implemented. I have not tested it, but I read through its source code and see it seems really, really neat. It even has a remarkable test suite. Thank you, Joshua Reeder, for telling me. And there are other libraries. libsimd-pp-papu-vielas-kanapiekkas has a greater support for different simd architectures than boost.simd does, but it lacks as complete a mathematical function library as boost.simd has. Then there was some confusion about the words I said about compilers and optimizations. First, how good compilers are at optimizing simd? The answer is, in general, really bad. To paraphrase Floodyberry's reply at Reddit, to take advantage of the compiler's simd optimizations, you must explicitly design and write your code as if you were writing simd intrinsics, with attention to data layout, working in blocks, and so on, and then just hope the compiler does its thing. But it is not reliable, and your mileage depends on the compiler, and even on the compiler version. There is a good reason why X264, a well-known free software library for a particular type of video transcoding, has a significant portion of its source code written in assembler. But I also said that the notion that you should not try to beat your compiler at optimization is hogwash. In the general case, you should stick to that principle. Very often it does not matter whether compiler generates most optimal code or not. If you are invoking system library functions, like for instance reading a file, chances are that any minuscule improvements that you might achieve by architecture-dependent expert hacker optimizations are totally irrelevant, because the operating system calls are an order of magnitude slower than your code. Or perhaps you might otherwise be able to change the entire algorithm into a categorically faster one if you didn't taint your code with micro-optimizations that prevent you from seeing the big picture. And as a consequence, your code is not only slower than it could be, but also unmaintainable because of the fragile micro-optimizations. You see, compilers are very good at optimizing regular code. The more average your code is, the better they are at optimization. For example, very often you can find that an extremely complicated and sophisticated template struct magic thing in C++ has been optimized down into just a couple of register movement instructions in assembler, as I demonstrated in the C++4C Programmer's Lesson 1 video. And that is as it should be. So I would just like to clarify that thing. It is only when you get down into very sophisticated level of detail in performance-critical, self-contained, concise code that you might be able to outsmart the compiler and achieve tangible benefit if you know exactly what you are doing. After episode 2, some people wanted to know how does the performance get altered if we use both threads and simd, but not GPU offloading. Well, I had initially considered that a bit too niche request, but I made a chart anyway. Here it is. Episode 3 left one question hanging. Why was the performance in the OpenMP and OpenACC versions so bad? Well, first of all, there was a misconception on my part. In both versions, I had a clause that caused a couple of simple variables to be copied to the GPU memory. This was actually a bad idea, because what it means that memory will be separately allocated on the GPU for those variables. It is better to default those variables as first private, meaning they are treated like function parameters. Secondly, in the OpenMP version I had a collapse clause, which was a good idea, but in the OpenACC version I didn't have it. This was totally an oversight from my part. I forgot to check whether OpenACC has something similar, and yes, it does. After fixing these two problems, the OpenACC performance reached almost the same level as the CUDA version, although it's still not quite there for some reason. The OpenMP version is still slow though. Why is it so slow is still a total mystery. My guess is that the GCC implementation is still so very recent that it is immature and largely unoptimized, and because of this it has a number of performance problems that have yet to be weeded out. Quite a lot of people were a little disappointed that I only covered CUDA in the video and not OpenCL. For those who don't know, CUDA is a thing developed by NVIDIA in 2007. It has only been ever supported by NVIDIA cards. Users of cards from other manufacturers like ATI or Intel had nothing of the sort. And then OpenCL was developed in 2009. OpenCL is now supported by a number of graphics card manufacturers and also by a few other sorts of compute devices. It should obviously be the better choice, right? Why did I not cover it in my video series? There's three reasons. Firstly, from the start my video series was going to be about ways to do parallelism in GCC without installing anything extra. The focus was going to be GCC and nothing else. Back then I had a graphics card that a friend lent to me. The graphics card was the NVIDIA GTX 560, which only has compute level 2. The code generated by GCC requires compute level 3, so I was unable to actually test the code generated by GCC, except with extraordinary hacks. So I grew generally curious and tried out CUDA. And it was surprisingly easy, and I thought to myself, I must introduce this to people too. A couple of months later, I actually did buy an NVIDIA GTX 970 using money contributed by Patreon supporters, and I was finally able to try the GCC offloading code on the actual device. But at that point my GCC installation was broken and none of the offloading versions worked. It was only after GCC 7 was released that I tried reinstalling the offloading GCC builds, and I figured out that ditching HSM support made it work, so I began making the videos. The second reason is that when I wanted to check out OpenCL back then, for some reason or another I had troubles getting it working on my computer. I can no longer remember what those problems were. Whatever the case, it kept me from trying out OpenCL. The third reason is that, look at OpenCL. This is supposed to be a simple example of using OpenCL. It's ugly, so much boilerplate code. So much stuff you must set up and initialize and prepare and configure and functions you must call in order to accomplish anything. Nope. That's not how you do usability for programmers. That's just not my style. It doesn't make for a good and easily understandable entertaining lesson in a YouTube video. You do that kind of thing when you have no choice. When it's just the way things have to be done, but it is not the way that is fun to code and to learn. There is one more way to leverage GPU power. That is by using OpenGL or maybe Vulkan or a certain vendor-specific library. Compute shaders can be used to do arbitrary calculation on the GPU, and the best thing is they work on nearly all graphics cards and operating systems. The downside is that compute shaders are used exclusively for GPUs. You cannot use them to offload computation for coprocessors like the Xeon Phi. So why did I not cover compute shaders in my video series? Simply because the focus was from the beginning how to do parallelism in GCC. And libraries like OpenGL and Vulkan do not come supplied with GCC, nor are they part of the C++ standard. that, and I was only too vaguely aware of the existence of compute shaders as a separate and usable class of shaders compared to, say, vertex shaders. But now you do know, and you can go ahead studying and learning more. Finally, there were one or more requests to see the different renderers in real time. So here is a desktop recording of each program rendering the fractal in real time at 480p resolution. Do note that because I am also using the same computer to record the desktop and transcode it into a video file, I'm not getting as good performance as I would if the fractal renderer were the only program running. And that is the extent of material I had prepared for this video. So thank you for watching and see you next time. Bye!